What a gorgeous morning we have today. Seems fitting to have that kind of weather for Mother's Day. And so, mothers, we're here to say thank you today. And our whole service is going to be sort of centered around that. First and foremost, we're here to lift up our praises to God and to give thanks for our moms and for all the other blessings that He's given to us as well. So go ahead and greet a mom today. Give her a hug if you want. Have some fun today. Greet one another, will you? Again, we want to just extend a warm welcome and a welcome to Madison Church of Christ. It's an honor and a privilege anytime a visitor comes. And so if you're a visitor here today, we say thank you. We just want you to participate and worship with us. When the offering plates comes around, you don't have to be uncomfortable. If you're a visitor, just pass it by if you don't feel comfortable. But if you're a member, you got to unload the billfold today. So no, you don't have to do that. No, if you're a visitor, we want you to feel comfortable, and sometimes it can be awkward if you're not used to going to a church, but if those things come to you and you don't know what to do, don't worry about it. Just come next week and you'll be used to it, that's all. So anyway, we love having visitors again. Just a couple announcements we want to make you aware of. Well, we will try to reschedule the Holiday Lake outing that got postponed due to the cold and the wet weather this past Wednesday, so we'll let you know if and when that can come. Hopefully early summer we'll do something as a church family that way. VBS workers, we're in the process of recruiting VBS workers, so if you love kids, if you love the Lord, this is a great week. If you like those two things, we can do those two things together all week long as we try to impart God's word to young children. It's a great opportunity for us to love on the children of this community. And so if you want to be part of that, if your mornings are free, there's a sign up out there in the entryway, and I know Renee would be glad to put you to work. No matter what your interest is, there's a place for you to serve, and so check that out. Also, the church pictures are in, and Renee has those today. So if you signed up for one of those pictures, see Renee. Is there anything else you need on that, Renee? Nope, we're good on that. Are there any other announcements that I'm not aware of that we need to make known today? So, all right, with that, we're going to head into our prayer time. Randy?
Morning. As we come into our prayer time, if you have any written requests, go ahead and hold them up, and usher can bring them up. If you look on the back there, we want to remember our college graduates. It's an important day in their life, so we'll hope things go well for them. As far as some updates from some of the ones from last week, my Aunt Louise Evans got home from the hospital after they had surgery on Monday. I think she got home Thursday. Things seem to be going well, but you get a plate put in your leg, it takes a little while to get used to that, I'm sure. Moving on down a little bit, Abby Hunter is Helga's granddaughter. She's 10 years old. She fell out of a second-story window and landed on a rose bush. And so, thankful maybe that the rose bush broke her fall, but I bet that didn't feel very good either. Jessica Blake, I talked to her mother this morning. She's doing fairly well, still has her jaw wired shut and a neck brace on, but seems to be doing okay. Talked to Charlie about Tina Puffenbarger there. That is his cousin, not his niece, but she's not doing so well right at the moment. They had to amputate some more of her foot, and they're not really sure if she's going to make it or not. So some prayers are needed there. Any more on Bonnie, Charlie? She's still doing okay?
She didn't have any more blood this week, so she's doing okay.
Okay, well, thankful for that then. I talked about Colleen Arp. She got some test results back this week, and good news is that the chemo seems to be working. So continued prayer there. We're thankful for that. I got a thing here for Neva Jo Harwood for new spiritual and physical health following her injuries from a fall and her surgery. So it's an acquaintance of yours, I'm assuming. Okay. Someone Rose knows. Anybody else? Yeah, Edie.
It's kind of
Okay, so that's Debbie Michael. She going to have more treatments in, or just waiting to see what? Okay. Well, we'll keep her in prayer, and we'll also keep you and the rest of your family in prayer, too. So remember Debbie Michael as she's dealing with cancer. Anybody else? Thankful for today and a wonderful day for all the moms. I hope you guys had a good breakfast this morning. We had a pretty good service, us guys in at Brooklyn Community Estates, and I think they enjoyed it. So if not, we'll go ahead and pray and move forward. Almighty God, Father in heaven, we are so thankful for this day to be in your house. We ask that you're with us. Let your spirit be on us as we worship you today. And we have quite a list of those who are in need of your healing and your strength and your loving touch, Lord. We ask that you're with them and the families of those listed. And we thank you so much for the blessings we've gotten and that you've given to us. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand and let's read together from God's Word, reading from Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, saying, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth, saying, let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth
children would like to come down front. Sherry will have our children's message. What's that? Oh, was it supposed to be?
Good morning. It's good to see all you guys. The girls are outnumbered today, huh? What is today?
Mother's Day.
Mother's Day, that's right. Did you give your mom a hug? Yeah, tell her happy Mother's Day. Well, I have a question for you guys. In your house, I want you to raise your hand if you have one of these in your house, okay? Do you guys have a transportation director in your home? How about a personal dietitian? A fashion coordinator? Do you have one of them? You do? A landscaper? A pediatric physician? Do you have one of them at your house? An interior designer? A family historian? An arbitrator? Or a personal coach? Do you guys have any of them? Are those weird words? You don't know what I'm talking about? Well, I'll tell you here. These jobs are really big jobs that people would have in this world. But you know what? All of us, even when I was little, we have these right in our homes. Who would that person be that could do all these jobs? Huh? Dad? Huh? Who? Mom. That's right. The landscaping dads might do, yeah. Well, moms decide what we can eat, don't they? Like if you want one more Oreo, do moms usually say no? Because they want us to eat what's right, don't they? The fashion coordinator is the person who buys and washes and lets us know if we are wearing is appropriate for the occasion, right? Moms usually do that. The landscaper is one who might mow the lawn or plant the flowers or shrubs and add decoration outside your home. And like you said, dads can help with that, can't they? So a pediatric physician, that's a doctor that takes care of kids. So lots of times moms do those kinds of things when you have a sore throat or a splinter. Who do you go to usually? Mom. The interior designer is one that makes the inside of the house look nice and help keep it clean. And a family historian, that's kind of a big word. That would be somebody that would take care of all the family pictures. Do any of your mom's scrapbook? Yeah. So they're going to, and moms can usually remember to a T the day that you were born, right? So, what? Really? Your mom doesn't scrapbook? That's okay. An arbitrator, what do you think that word is? That's a big word. Can you guess? What do you think? An arbitrator is one who breaks up fights or arguments. Do you ever fight with your siblings? Never? And finally, a personal coach. I hope that we all have personal coaches in our home. And I think our moms and dads are both personal coaches, aren't they? They're going to help us through challenges, teach us new skills that we need to get through life. But the amazing part of all this, it sums up with three letters, M-O-M, right? But when we read Proverbs 29:31, we find that a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her reward she has earned, and let her works be known at the city gates. So did you know that your moms do all those kinds of things for you guys? Yeah, that's pretty special, isn't it? Today when you go home, why don't you guys do something special for your mom? Show her the way that you could love her, like by cleaning your room, or, you know, maybe if she asks you to do something, you'll do it without arguing, right? Or that would be a nice thing to do. Or you could go home and find out something special about your mom besides all the things she does for you. Find out what she likes, like her favorite color or her favorite flower. You know, stuff like that. That would be special. Okay, I'm going to hand these out. You can take one and pass it. We'll close in prayer. Dear God, we thank you so much that we have moms, that you have given them to us to help do all those things for us. And Lord, help us be appreciative and grateful for all that they do. And we just thank you for being our Father and loving us so much. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Sherry. Good thoughts about moms today. I wanted to just let everybody know, I jumped on a four-wheeler this week. Oh, no, I didn't jump on a four-wheeler this week, Marvin. I'm still smiling when I hear that, or think about that story. I don't know if I'll ever get that one out of my mind, so. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you got to ask Marvin about his four-wheeling story that he shared last Sunday. It was, we'll remember it for a long, long time. I'll put it that way. So, today we shift our focus and our attention to our moms, and probably stirs lots of memories for us. It did me. I had a wonderful Christian mother that, when I think back, we had this going on for a long time. But now my mom and I are close, and about once a week we'll talk, But we had some friction in the high school years, especially, and I hate to admit it, but she was right. When I began to honor my mom that way after coming to, it's kind of funny. I looked back at my Bible, and just some of the things I underlined, just talked about honoring my mom. And as soon as I learned to honor my mom, there was peace in the home, and I understood that. Maybe I had the key to peace in my house as a teenager even. And so if you're a teenager here today and you're battling with moms and dads, maybe you hold the key to peace. And maybe God does know what he talks about when he says, honor your father and your mother. It doesn't mean you like all of that. But and so I'm flooded with those memories. I'm flooded with a memory of buying her a 5-iron for her Mother's Day gift one year. There was a garage sale and there was a beautiful 5-iron. And I just figured she might like a 5-iron. So... not sure she ever used it. She didn't use it on me anyway, but she did get a 5-iron. Maybe you've heard the joke. I think all of us kids understand this. Anyone know what the word casserole means? We never did know what the word casserole meant. I've concluded that it means that I didn't have time to go to the store this week, and that's what casserole means. I think everything got thrown together, and so, but maybe you're flooded with your own mom stories, good or bad or otherwise. I could tell a funny one on Barb probably, but we were going on a family vacation. Here we go. This isn't in my notes. This is the Holy Spirit guiding, I think. We were going on vacation. We left early and we didn't have breakfast, so we stopped at Hardee's at Tama on our way to go canoeing and I can't remember what it was. Anyway. We were eating breakfast or whatever it was, and Wade, our oldest son, was drinking his drink and eating, and all of a sudden he kind of was choking, and it got sort of serious, and poor Barb, she was kind of panicky and not knowing what to do, and he's kind of gasping for air, and she didn't know what to do, so she just like turned him around and just started beating on his back. It's like, I think I'm supposed to do something like that, but I think she would have got picked up for assault because Wade's like, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, moms are great. Thanks for letting me tell that story, Barb. Okay, we'll jump in here a little bit, try to get something spiritual out of today's message. Here's some things about moms, too, as we introduce. An anonymous son wrote these observations about his mom. He said, his mother taught him logic. She once asked, if everyone else jumped off a cliff, would you do it, too? His mother taught him about medicine. If you don't stop crossing your eyes, they're going to freeze that way. His mom taught him how to become an adult. If you don't eat your vegetables, you'll never grow up. His mom taught him about genetics. You are just like your father. His mother taught him about roots. Says, do you think you were born in a barn? His mother taught him about the wisdom of age. When you get to be my age, you will understand. Or I'll explain it to you when you get older. His mother taught him about anticipation. Anticipation. Just wait until your father gets home. And the all-time favorite thing his mother taught him was justice. One day you will have kids, and I hope they turn out to be just like you. Then you'll see what it's like. I think my mom has apologized several times to Barb for praying that prayer. We had some kids that were somewhat like me. I don't think she got a five iron, but anyway. Today we honor our moms, and we just want to pay tribute to them. It's good for us to do those things occasionally. I enjoy holidays. I think holidays give us sometimes a chance to reflect on things that influence our life, either whether they have a spiritual root to them or not. I think some of them really help us, and Mother's Day is one of those. Obviously, we don't meet at church this morning because of our moms necessarily. We come because we're Christians and we're followers of Jesus and we want to lift up the Lord, but we also want to pay tribute to our moms and to say, God, we're thankful for our mothers, and I am. I'm thankful for the spiritual influence my mother had as a child, and definitely has left her mark on me. By the time a child reaches 18, a mother has had to handle some 18,000 hours of child-generated work. And in fact, it says women who have never had children enjoy an equivalent of extra 3 months of year in leisure time. Somehow, I'm not sure if that works out, but a junior high science teacher lectured on the properties of magnets for an entire class. The next day, he gave his students a quiz. The first question read like this: my name begins with M. It has six letters, and I pick things up. What am I? Half of the kids in the class wrote mother. Okay? Moms. God's word is full of great pictures, portraits of moms throughout Scripture, and I just came up with these real quick. How about Moses? The mother of Moses cared for her son so much that she really broke the law in order to teach him about the faith of his people. We all probably remember the story of a sacrificial love of a mother who appeared before King Solomon, the wise man that he was, and told him she was willing to have her son taken away by another woman rather than see harm or death come to him. Remember that story? I remember that as a kid. Or how about the mother of James and John, who loved her boy so much that she wanted them to sit by the Lord's side in the heavenly kingdom? I would have hated to see her Facebook page. It would have been full of pictures of the kids. And the mother of King Lemuel. Maybe you've never heard of him, but we read from Proverbs 31 earlier. The mother of King Lemuel made him learn this oracle, Proverbs 31, and all about godly living and a good wife. So we're thankful for those moms in Scripture. There's lots more. But as we kind of kick this off, we're also, Mother's Day isn't always warm and fuzzy for everybody. And I came across this. This isn't anything I wrote, but I really appreciated it as it gives us perspective on Mother's Day. So we pay tribute to those who gave birth this year to their first child. If that's you, we celebrate with you. To those who perhaps lost a child this year, we mourn with you. To those who are in the trenches with little ones every day and wear the badge of food stains, we appreciate you. To those who experienced loss this year through miscarriage, failed adoptions, or running away, we mourn with you. To those who have had to walk the hard path of infertility, you might have been poked at, you might have been prodded, there might be tears and disappointment, but if that's your case, we walk with you. Forgive us when we say foolish things. We don't mean to make this harder than it is. To those who are foster moms, mentor moms, and spiritual moms, we need you. To those who have warm and close relationships with your children, we celebrate you. To those who have disappointment, heartache, and distance with your children, we sit with you. To those who lost their mothers this year, we grieve with you. To those who have experienced abuse at the hands of your own mother, we acknowledge that experience. To those who lived through driving tests, medical tests, and the overall testing of motherhood, we are better for having you in our midst. To those who will have emptier nests in the upcoming year, we grieve and rejoice with you. Maybe there's someone here that's pregnant with new life, both expecting and surprising. We anticipate those days with you. This Mother's Day, we walk with you. Mothering is not for the faint of heart, and we have real warriors in our midst. Moms, we remember you. This morning in our lesson time, our scripture time, I want to just wrap up my thoughts in a sentence. This is my sermon in a sentence today. A mother can make a significant spiritual impact on her children with or without the help of a father. Entitled today's message, A Grandmother, A Mother, and a Boy. And I just want to just quickly go through this story. It's short scripture passages that we'll be in today. But it's a story about a young woman named Eunice. We've actually been talking about her a little bit in Sunday school. She was raised in a religious home. She was greatly impacted by her mother. Her mother's name was Lois. So we have Eunice and Lois, the grandma. And she loved to learn the stories from the Bible when she was young. She went to the church services that they had there, and she just enjoyed being a part about learning about God. As she approached her teenage years, I think she was probably a spiritual teenage girl, but also she was attracted by somebody not so spiritual. And probably against the prodding of her mother and the wisdom of her mother, she married someone that was not of the faith, for sure. He was probably a nice guy, but I think he probably thought religion or spiritual matters were for weak people. And so she bore the burden of raising any children that they would have in the Lord. After a couple years of marriage, Eunice and her husband had a baby boy whom they named Timothy. In the meantime, Eunice's dad, this is the grandma's dad, had died, so she comes to live with Lois, or Eunice, and her husband. And so now grandma's in the house. Not that unusual for us today to see that type of thing happen. Little Timmy was a delight to everyone, and both mom and grandma spent hours with him. And they would teach him the stories of the Old Testament. They would pray with him and for him, and they would train him in a godly fashion. And they didn't probably have VBS or children's ministries. They took care of that themselves, and they created an environment where Timothy could grow in the Lord. One day, a preacher named Paul, whom we're very familiar with, came to their town of Lystra and preached God's word and spoke about a man named Jesus. Lois and Eunice listened intently, and they were good learners, and they were able to see in Jesus the fulfillment of all the scriptures. Hard for us to put that in perspective. That would have been hard at that time. And Paul came in preaching Jesus, and they were familiar with all the Old Testament and all that happened there, but they were converted and gave their lives to the Lord, and these new believers focused on teaching Timothy all about who Jesus was. As we know from our perspective, if we read the book of Acts, Paul himself took a real personal interest in young Timothy and probably mentored him as well. And so with Paul and Lois and Eunice, he was very fortunate to have had the spiritual guidance that he received. And that led him to this saving faith. We also know later Paul and Timothy became partners together in ministry, and they traveled and did a lot of preaching together, and they spread the gospel throughout the area. And Paul, later on in prison, writes a couple of letters to Timothy. 1st and 2nd Timothy are those letters that Paul writes, and they're very personal letters, and we've preached from a couple of those passages before where Timothy is taken on a new church, and he says, be strong in grace, mentor others, and gives instruction on Timothy as a new pastor what to do. Great letters. They filled with reminiscing, filled with nostalgia on Paul's part, and he reflects, even in those letters, on the influence that grandma and mom had on young Timothy. With that sort of backdrop and that sort of short history lesson, I just want to highlight some areas for our moms today, and we're going to jump into that. First of all, they passed a respect for Scripture on to young Timothy. They passed a respect for Scripture. Why don't you turn your Bibles real quick if you want, just short passages today, 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're just going to briefly look what Paul writes here. And again, we can learn a lot from just these couple short passages. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Paul just got done reminding Timothy that as a Christian, there's going to be persecution. That's just part of it. And we probably don't understand that as much as Timothy did. But maybe there will come a day when we understand even more and more. And you can see those days. It wouldn't be hard to imagine those days even in our country. 2 Timothy 3, verse 12. He reminds them, everybody, that there's going to be persecution. Then in verse 14, he says, hang tough. He says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it. He says, continue in what you have learned. You've been taught since infancy. He goes on to say that in verse 15. And how from infancy, that is from a very, as a baby, from very youngest of ages, you were taught to know the Holy Scriptures. Those were able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. In the manner, these were devout Israelite women, Lois and Eunice, and they taught the Scriptures to Timothy from the very beginning, before he could even walk. It's amazing what kids can learn. Lois and Eunice teamed up together and provided this little Sunday school lesson probably daily for him, and Timothy was able to learn. He probably heard stories about Samson and Samuel and David and Ruth and Abraham and Noah, same stories that we still teach our children today. And they did everything they could do to provide Timothy with this environment where his faith could grow, where he could come to a knowledge of Jesus Christ. They lived out the commands of Deuteronomy 6, an Old Testament passage they were probably familiar with. And we're going to look at this passage later in the fall. Actually, we're going to do a series on the family, and that's going to be the basis for it. So you'll hear more about Deuteronomy later in September. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. They would have known this by heart. They would have had it memorized. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. I think Lois and Eunice modeled that. It was just a part of who they were. The faith in their hearts just spilled over into their language at home, and they just created an environment outside of church where faith was just a natural part of their experience. These two women, they had God's word in their hearts. There's no doubt about it. They had the truth in their lives, and they impressed it on young Timothy. Moms, it's never too early to start teaching God's word to your children. And it's never too late to start if you haven't done so already. Most of you are probably going, I could have done a better job at that. We all could have. But it's never too late to start to show the importance. I appreciate Barb. She did a better job at modeling and reading God's word at home better than I did for our boys. And every morning, of course, they were in bed part of the time, but Barb's very good about reading her Bible every morning. Not trying to make her more than it is, but she's a lesson to our boys and to me. And it's never too late to show the importance of God's word. I would say read it in your living room so your kids can see you reading it. They see that as an important time, and it models it for them. Leave the Bible out. Pick it up. Read a scripture or passage at lunch or supper. Let them know that you think and you highly regard God's word. What kind of Bible is your child reading when they observe your life, moms? Do you look for ways to instill God's word as a part of their life and a part of their experience? You can make a significant impact on the life of your children with or without the help of a father. Not only did they pass on a respect and a high value of Scripture onto Timothy, they modeled this in a sincere faith. 2 Timothy 1:5 says, I've been reminded of your sincere faith, or authentic faith, the real thing, which first lived in your grandmother Lois. Again, here's Paul writing Timothy. He says, I'm reminded of the sincere faith that you have, which first you found from grandma, and then from your mom, Lois, or Eunice, and I'm persuaded now, Paul says, resides in you. Paul noticed the influence of these two women. Nothing's ever said about any men there. So you can have a significant impact even without a man. Now, I'm not trying to, guys, you aren't off the hook. Father's Day is coming up. You'll get your turn. Okay? But these two women saw the importance of God's word, and they modeled a sincere faith. That word sincere is just a word that means authentic or real, the real deal. They weren't going or faking their way through their faith. It was just a part of who they were, and Timothy got to see that. They were completely sold out to Jesus Christ. They took their faith seriously as a mom and as a grandma, and they were devoted and they were committed, and they knew they wanted Timothy to grow in his faith. No one knows it better than a child if our faith isn't the real deal. I've spent a lot of years in youth ministry. They know if someone's faking it or not. Our children get to see us at our best and our worst. They know our flaws. They know we screw up. They know our attitudes and our actions. But hopefully they know our hearts. Are our hearts right with the Lord? And it doesn't hurt for us to say I'm sorry, to model that. We're not perfect as parents. But our kids know when we're faking or when we're trying to put on a mask. Again, moms, you have an opportunity to impact the lives of your children in a spiritual manner, with or without a dad. If you're just going through the motions as a mom, maybe today's just a reminder that my kids see in that, and we'll probably model that. and they may do the same thing when they're older as well. And so as you demonstrate your faith by consistently putting time in God's Word, but consistent church attendance might be a part of that, praying, sitting down and having a conversation with your kids about faith, those are important times. If they see you involved in the mission of the church and God's work as a kingdom worker, those things are caught oftentimes. Heard a story about a pastor who was talking to a member of his church, and when he said to the young man, he said, "Are you ready to join the church?" And he said he was. The pastor was curious. He said, "Well, what did we do or what did we say that convinced you should be part of this church?" And the man answered, "It was nothing I ever heard you say. It was the way my mom lived her life." All of us understand that has a greater impact than the words we say when people live their lives and model sincere faith. I think that's what happened in this story today. Timothy just had a grandma and a mom who loved him deeply and modeled a deep faith. Is that important to you as a mom today? It's not difficult as a mom. You feel lots of pressures. As Sherry shared, you have to wear lots of hats, lots of things. And sometimes our priorities as parents can get a little skewed at times too in this world. But I want to challenge you this. Are you more interested in your children's souls than in their physical bodies or the clothes that they wear? Are you more interested in their eternal life than their success in their 60, 70, 80 years that they'll have there on earth or during their teenage years? Are you more concerned about your child's relationship with Jesus than popularity in the hallways of their school? Are you more concerned about how they stand before God rather than how they stand in their status and in the social sphere that they live in? Are you more concerned about their spirituality than their intellectual, musical, or athletic accomplishments? Might be striking a nerve, and some of those are hard. There's lots of pressures. No doubt, doesn't say in our text, but no doubt, Eunice and Lois were praying women. Lots of passages in Scripture that talk about women praying, and Acts 12:12 says the mother of John Mark opened up her home for a prayer meeting. Acts 1:14, Mary, the mother of Jesus, joined together constantly in prayer. It's not mentioned, but I think moms that love their kids are praying moms, and we lift up our kids before the Father. Timothy's family environment allowed him to grow in his faith, and we're thankful that he did. We see a lot of things from his life, and Paul's ministry was greater because of that mom and that grandma's passing their faith on to their children. We know we can't do that. We know we can't. It's not hereditary. Passing our faith on is something we can just say, here, it's yours. We can pass on whatever family heirlooms we want, but we can't pass our faith on to our children. All we can do is model it and let them decide for themselves. Finally, I think Timothy saw from Eunice and Lois a desire to be part of a kingdom worker, to be a servant, to give their lives to the kingdom. And in Acts 16:1, we see that Paul came to Derbe and then Lystra, and a disciple named Timothy, where Timothy lived, whose mother was a Jewess and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The brothers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him, and Paul wanted to take him on a missionary journey. He was a strong believer. He was referred to as a disciple. That was a strong. It didn't say he was just a believer or a Christian. He was a disciple. He was a devoted follower of Jesus. Paul saw that and wanted that as a partner. Secondly, he had a good reputation. Says he was well thought of. Grandma and mom probably had a lot to do with that as well. And lastly, he was available for the Lord's work. I think that's important. It's a thrill to see kids grow up in ministry. This church has been blessed as they've seen many kids grow up in ministry. Now, don't misunderstand me. If you're a kid going to ministry, that is no less of a calling. But it's meaningful for a church family to have Timothys who are serving all over the world, and this church has been blessed. For a small congregation, you've touched their lives. And so, moms, you've played a part in that. But Timothy made himself available and was able to accompany Paul because he had a good reputation and he was a disciple. Moms, your job is to instill a respect for God's word, to model an authentic faith, and to encourage them to be a kingdom worker no matter what they do. Well, I always get a kick. We call our those who go into ministry Timothys, but we have Timothys in our own churches. They may be teaching Sunday school. They may be mowing the yard. They may be doing something. But those are Timothys. They're all serving the Lord to the best of their abilities. And so if you're still serving the Lord, even though you haven't gone somewhere else, I think you're a Timothy. And this church and other churches I've been associated with, I've been fortunate to have Timothys who stay at home and teach Sunday school or whatever they're called to do, and they do it. Moms, you can make a significant spiritual impact in the lives of your kids with or without a father. We do that by passing on a respect for Scripture, by modeling a sincere or an authentic or a real faith, and also giving them a desire, a taste of what ministry can be like. I'm going to invite our worship team to come up. As we close, I just have this last story. Four scholars were arguing over Bible translation. One said he preferred the King James Version because of its beauty and its eloquent Old English style. Another said he liked the New American Standard Version for its literalism and how it moves the reader from passage to passage with confident feelings of accuracy for the original text. The third scholar was sold on the New Living Translation for its use of contemporary phrases and idioms that capture the meaning of difficult ideas. It's easy to understand. And after being quiet for a moment, the fourth scholar admitted, "I personally preferred my mom's translation." And the other scholar started laughing. He said, "Yes, she translated the Scriptures. My mom translated each page of the Bible into life. It was the most convincing translation I have ever read." Moms, we applaud you today. We encourage you to take seriously the spiritual impact that you have in your children's life, no matter what age they are. Proverbs 31:28 says, "Her children arise and call her blessed." And so today, Mom, we want to call you blessed as well. We're grateful for you, the impact that you've had in our lives, and we want to honor you today. So moms, we hope you feel loved and special today. We're going to sort of shift gears and go from moms to a Heavenly Father. Not only do our moms love us, but we have a Heavenly Father who loves us, and He gave His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for us. And so as we shift gears, let the music just kind of bring you into tune with Him as we get ready to celebrate the Lord's Supper.
Thank you. and tithes, we ask that you bless my holy name. Amen.
Thanks for all the impact you've had on us. We want to walk along with, besides moms and dads, this church, and if we can do anything to help you out as parents or grandparents, we want to do that. I was sorting through my office stuff this last week. I have a lot of books from parenting. If you're a young parent and want to read some books, give me a holler. You're welcome to take any books that I have, and we want to resource you with the best we can to help you. It's not an easy task to be a mom nor a dad. Dads will get you in a month or so, but moms, if we can do anything to encourage you the best way we can. One neat thing about this church is it has some great resources, and those resources are you. They really are. That's better than a book. Call someone who's walked through those difficult days and ask them questions, and so maybe we can figure out how to do that, but they're you get to our age, we want to help you, younger parents. We want to mentor you and say, hey, we don't have all the answers, but this is what we would do, or this is just one thing that worked for us, and that's the resource, that's the beauty of the church. So if we can help you raise your kids, that's why we do Sunday school and our Wednesday night program, to come alongside parents to encourage you and to what you're trying to do at home as well. Let's see, starting a new series next week, Life's Too Short. Life's too short for what? I don't know. Somebody said life's too short not to eat chocolate. So moms, I hope you enjoy your chocolate today. Life's too short not to fish. I would say that. I better not share what Jamie said. You can ask him one-on-one, but I'm not going to say it from here. Next week, actually this was a common, life's too short to be bitter, to hold a grudge, Have we all not done that? Maybe we're doing that now. So we're going to look at kind of a heavy subject next week. Life's too short to live in bitterness. God has something way better for you. So maybe you can bring something and just leave it at church that day, and there's forgiveness and joy. So we're going to look at lots of things. Life's too short to be selfish. I don't even know where we're going with it, but for the next 3 or 4 weeks, we're going to have some life's too short. And thank you. Some of you gave me some good ideas, and we'll go with some of those. But anyway, that's come up. Why don't you stand, and while closing prayer, and we'll be dismissed. Father, we're thankful for the gifts that you put in our lives, and today we're thankful for the moms that have influenced us, and even we're sensitive to those who want to be moms and weren't able to or had a rough experience, so we're sensitive to that, but we're thankful for those ladies here today that have modeled their faith and have done their best to live that out. So we encourage that. We want to encourage that in each and every member of this church, that we want to be disciples and we want to pass the faith on as best we can. So help us to do that. Help us not just to do that with our families, but to reach out to our community as well, a coworker or someone that we know that we can pray for and we can reach out to as well as we try to be lights in this Brooklyn community. God, thank you for everything that you do for us and for loving us with an everlasting love. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.